Well, good morning and welcome everybody here and everybody who is at home watching us online. We are Spirit of Hope United Church on 82nd Avenue at 79th Street in Edmonton. For those of us here in person, please stay for a time of visiting and refreshments after the service. You're welcome whether this is your first time here or you have come before. We welcome each other and share fully in the life of the church, regardless of age, ethnicity, gender identity, ability, sexual orientation, or economic circumstances. You are welcome as you are for who you are, equally loved and valued by God. As we work to recognize and give thanks for God's goodness in every moment of our lives, it becomes even more important for us to recognize and give thanks to those around us. This morning, like many mornings, we gather in this place built by the work of our ancestors, and this morning, like many mornings, we gather in this place built on the traditional lands of the First Nations. As you came in, you were offered a spark, and it's also available online if you prefer to read it that way. Are there any announcements which don't seem to be in the spark?
Good morning. My name is Vicki Nguyen, and I order the United Church calendars. Today is the last day to put your request in if you wish to purchase one, $10. The money is spent between my buying the calendars and the profit that I turn over to the church. So the money that I pay goes to the United Church, and the profit goes to our church, just so you know. And today is the last Jazz and Reflections concert of the fall season. It is a young saxophonist named Jacob Doe. He's bringing a trio. We do not know who the trio is, but he's coming with a trio. And I would like to take this time to say, with our church family, thank you so much to those who have been supportive of the Jazz and Reflections concerts. Whether it is you have fulfilled a volunteer job of doing a reflection, you've been a crew person, you've been a server, a baker, a welcomer, a sound person, a musician helper. Thank you so much. And to the church as a whole, thank you for providing this unbelievable venue for these internationally known local artists. When you see that there are 100 people, we're averaging between 80 and 100 people per concert here. It means so much to them to come into this space and listen to live music, something that we've treasured even more since the COVID lockdown. So thank you very much.
Good morning. My name is Kathy Martin, and I chair the Property Finance and Stewardship Committee. And I have some news from Catherine Perry, some sad news. Her brother passed away suddenly a few days ago, and she just asked that we keep her and Curtis and her family in our prayers.
The Halloween party is next Saturday, and we need volunteers to help. Yeah. We can only do a little bit. The rest of you, it's nice. Kim has a sign-up sheet. There's lots of sit-down jobs. You can sit at a craft table. You can watch people decorate cupcakes.
Yeah. We could play.
What?
We could play.
Oh, and we're going to do the parade at 3 o'clock. So come to the Halloween party. It's going to be fun. It's for all ages. You're welcome.
Wow, what a great warm-up for the choir. Okay. Today we are starting on a 6-week stewardship journey titled Celebrating Generosity, which will culminate on November 17th with a light lunch and opportunity for sharing ideas and reflections. And today as you arrived, a letter addressed to you was ready to be passed to you. But retrieve it as you exit if you missed it coming in, along with any other address to a friend's home where you could drop it off. Remaining letters will be mailed out on Tuesday. As was the practice during COVID, and as of next week, we now won't be passing the offering plates. A box for your offering will be placed as you enter at the sanctuary, and one will be available as you leave the sanctuary as well.
Well, good morning.
Good morning.
Who do you want to make an announcement? Go right ahead.
Hello. Yes, good morning, everyone. Most of you guys know me as a blind Frenchman attending this church, but a lot of you guys don't know. I mentioned to a couple of people, and some of you guys have impressed interest, so I just thought about mentioning to the whole congregation. I am also a writer, and my latest project is been writing some books, and right now I'm writing the first volume, which is Understanding World Religion. Kind of give you an idea about different faith, the way they act, the way they interpret their scripture, the ideology. So first volume should be done shortly, probably the next couple of weeks. And I was mentioning to Reverend Blaine, and he told me it's a pretty good idea. So the first volume is Christianity and Islam. The second will be Hinduism, Buddhism, and folks religion. And the last one will be no religion and smaller denomination. So the first volume will be finished shortly, which is Christianity and Islam. So try to look into the main denomination, whether it's Catholic, Protestant, Orthodox, Evangelical, Reformist. So it gives me an idea why people are acting the way they are. Let's say, for example, if you got some people preaching the word of God, let's say on the corner of the street, or why you got people kind of going to your door and try to say that their faith is better than yours, because it's part of their mandate. And why you got so many restrictions in the world. Same thing do in the Islam world. Islam is not a bad thing, but it's like Christianity. It's the extremist, the troublemaker, the way you interpret the scriptures and the ideology, which is bad. Because after all, doesn't matter what you are, everybody is the same. We all love one another, respect your neighbors, respect the word of nature, but it's the way you interpret things. If you interpret them to your own interest, that is bad. So I just thought about mentioning that, let's say, to all of you guys. If you are interested, just come down and see me. Cost of the volume would be probably between $35 to $40 each. And I was thinking that the proceeds can go towards Hope City Church. Spirit of Hope United Church. You know, so just come down and see me shortly after the service. Thank you.
Well, thank you, JP. And let's take a moment to greet each other, to welcome everyone to church today. We'll light a candle. We'll sing ourselves into worship and know that the Spirit of God is in our midst.
Spirit in me greets the Spirit in you. Alleluia. God's in us and we're in God. Alleluia. The Spirit in me greets the Spirit in you. Alleluia. God's in us and we're in God. Spirit in me greets the Spirit in you. Hallelujah. God's in us and we're in God. Hallelujah.
When we think we have figured out our place, our faith invites us to think more broadly. Our God is the author of all that is. We have learned a lot, but there is still mystery beyond our understanding. Let's pray together. Holy and patient God, we are humbled by the challenge before us. Be our guide and companion along the way. Amen.
God has made, we will rejoice and be glad. This is
Extra Yarn, book by Mac Barnett and illustrated by Joan Platt. One, on a cold afternoon in a cold little town, wherever you looked was either on either side was white snow or the black of soot and chimneys. Annabelle found a box filled with yarn of every color. So she went home and she knit a sweater for herself, and when Annabelle was done, she had some extra yarn. And so she knit a sweater for Mars, too. But there was still extra yarn. And when Annabelle and Mars went for a walk, Nate pointed, laughed, and said, "You two look ridiculous." "Well, you're just jealous," said Annabelle. "No, I'm not," said Nate. But it turned out he was. And even after she'd made a sweater for Nate and Nate's dog, and for herself and for Mars, she still had extra yarn. At school, Annabelle's classmates would not stop talking about her sweater. "Quiet," shouted Mr. Norman. "Quiet, everyone. Annabelle, that sweater of yours is a terrible distraction. I cannot teach with everyone turning around to look at you." "Well, then I'll knit one for everyone," said Annabelle, "so they won't have to turn around." "Impossible," Mr. Norman said. "You can't." But it turned out she could, and she did, even for Mr. Norman. And when she was done, Annabelle still had extra yarn. And so she knit sweaters for her mom and dad, and for Mr. Pendleton, and for Mrs. Pendleton, and for Dr. Palmer, and for little Lewis. She made sweaters for everyone. Well, except Mr. Crabtree, who never wore sweaters or even long pants, who would stand in his shorts with the snow up to his knees. "No sweater for me, thanks," said Mr. Crabtree. So she made Mr. Crabtree a hat. And even then, Annabelle still had extra yarn. So she made sweaters for all the dogs, for all the cats, and for other animals too, and soon people thought, "Annabelle soon will run out of yarn." But it turned out she didn't. So Annabelle made sweaters for things that didn't even wear sweaters. Things began to change in that little town. News spread of this remarkable girl who never ran out of yarn. And people came to visit from all around the world to see all of the sweaters and to shake Annabelle's hand. On one day, an archduke who was very fond of clothes sailed across the sea and demanded to see Annabelle. "Little girl," said the archduke, "I would love to buy that miraculous ball of yarn, box of yarn, and I'm willing to offer you $1,000,000. "No, thank you," said Annabelle, who was knitting a sweater for a pickup truck. The Archduke's mustache twitched. 2 million, he said. Annabelle shook her head. No thanks. 10 million, shouted the Archduke. Take it or leave it. Leave it, said Annabelle. I won't sell the arm. And she didn't. So that night, the Archduke hired 3 robbers to break into Annabelle's house, and they stole the box, and they took it to the Archduke, who set off across the snow and sailed over the sea. Back to his castle. The Archduke put on his favorite song and sat in his best chair, and he took out the box, and he lifted the lid, and he looked inside. His mustache quivered, it shivered, it trembled. The Archduke hurled the box out the window and shouted, "Little girl, I will curse you with my family's curse. You will never be happy again." But it turned out she was. I wonder why the Archduke didn't find any yarn. Maybe it's because he wanted it all for himself. Let's pray. Thank you, God.
Thank you, God.
For the chance.
For the chance.
To give.
To give.
Amen.
Thank you.
of first installment of Stewardship Scene. Stewardship reminds us that we are empowered to make choices with resources, whether of time or talent or wealth. We are called as individuals and as congregations and communities into God's mission. We participate by giving the gifts that God has entrusted to us. These gifts are everything that we have: our time, our talents and skills, and our treasure or physical resources. Christian stewardship includes all aspects of our lives. It is about our personal work and family life. It's about the good management of donations, including those made to our church. It's about our congregational and denominational life, which flows from our individual and collective desire to be part of God's mission for the world. Being stewards and encouraging all aspects of Christian stewardship is a critical role for all members of the United Church of Canada, and in particular, the congregational leadership. It's a ministry and formation process that requires support, education, and spiritual practice over time. The responsible use of God's gifts include the act of giving to the church a worthy portion of the time, money, and ability entrusted to us for its mission and ministry. We are moved to do this by gratitude to God and by the desire to answer His love by loving our neighbors and serving their needs. In Jesus, we most clearly see God's love in action. The first scripture is from Job 38, 4 through 7, and then 34 through 38. Where were you when I created the earth? If you know the answer, tell me. Who decided its size? Do you know? Who stretched the measuring line across it? In what foundation were its pillars sunk? Who laid the cornerstone? While all the choruses of morning stars sang and the heavenly court shouted for joy. Can you boom out your voice at the clouds and cause them to rain on command? Can you send the lightning on its way? Does it report back to you, here we are? Who instills the ibis with its prophetic wisdom? Where does the rooster pick up its intuition? Who classifies the clouds and pours out the heavenly water jars until the soil is muddy and the dust has become solid? And from Mark 10, 35 through 37 and 41 through 44. Zebedee's children, James and John, approached Jesus. Teacher, they said, we want you to grant our request. What is it? Jesus asked. They replied, see to it that we sit next to you, one at your right and one at your left, when you come into glory. The other 10, on hearing this, became indignant at James and John. Jesus called to them together and said, you know how many Gentiles, those who exercise authority, are domineering and arrogant. Those great ones know how to make their own importance felt. But it can't be like that with you. Anyone among you who aspires to greatness must serve the rest. Whoever wants to rank first among you must serve the needs of all. May we find inspiration from these words.
Amen.
Let's pray. Gracious God, we hear stories of ancient faith, and yet we continue to try and write the story of our faith today. Be with us in all that we do. Amen. I wonder how many others were like me this past week and found ourselves pausing to stare at the full moon, especially when it was kind of low in the sky. I did the math, and I have been breathing this planet's air for 761 full moons. Now, there were no doubt some cloudy nights along the way. There was probably a few that I just wasn't outside at the right time, and there would have been those early years when I would have had no idea what I was seeing if I was looking at all. But I think I've seen a few full moons. I've seen a lot of them. And seeing another one shouldn't be anything special. And yet it is. Through next weekend, visitors are going to be gathering in Jasper to stare at the dark sky. And they're going to marvel in silence and in conversation about what they're seeing. And thanks to the relatively small effects of human-created lights that blind us in our area from clear views, they'll get a chance to see more than we might see on a normal evening in Edmonton around here. Yes, there's constant movement within the cosmos, but this weekend's skies are essentially the same ones that we've looked at for our entire lives. Yes, we only get to see a portion of the visible sky depending upon the time of year and depending upon where on the globe we find ourselves, but it's basically the same sky that held my first and my 761st full moons. And every 29.5-day lunar cycle in between. And yet, even though nothing has essentially changed, I, and maybe we, still look up in wonder and amazement and consider anew the complexity and the beauty of all that can be seen, both with our naked eye and, when we're fortunate, through the best of telescopes and cameras that we can access. You know, I love that Harry Chapin song that he ended almost all of his concerts with, where he sang, "All my life's a circle, sunrise and sundown. The moon rolls through the nighttime till the daybreak comes around. All my life's a circle, but I can't tell you why. Seasons spinning round again, the years keep rolling by." The moon circling the earth circling the sun circling galactic center, the Milky Way racing around in the dark. Time may be relatively linear, but life is a circle. Round and round again, I am re-given opportunities to sit in awe of the wonders of existence. And the spiritual person in me is very grateful to the divine source of this awesome creation. And I, like so many psalmists and prophets and preachers, thank God for all that is, for the foundations of the earth, which sustains my life, for the song of morning stars, for the patterns of snow, wind, and rain. I can appreciate that there are those times when Jesus' close followers seemed a bit out of sync with him. And it's clear that the trio of Simon and James and John made up an inner circle of the 12-person inner circle. These three were the ones that went with Jesus to see Jairus' daughter when he called that 12-year-old back to life. These were the ones that joined Jesus on the mountain of Transfiguration, where law and prophets mysteriously combine with their experience of Jesus. And these are they that Jesus had asked to stay awake with him as he went a little deeper into the Garden of Gethsemane to pray. You'd think if any of Jesus' disciples would understand Jesus' way, it would be John and Simon Peter and James. But as we heard from our reading from Mark today, two-thirds of that inner circle had a question for the rabbi. When you come into your glory, Jesus, we would like the honor of sitting right beside you. Can you promise us those places? Now, James's and John's imaginations of glory were limited by their worldview, and what they had to draw on was their knowledge that powerful earthly sovereigns sat often figuratively, but very sometimes literally, over those whom they had dominion over. And their most trusted and powerful deputies would sit close, no doubt in smaller and lower chairs, but right up there. Now, James and John want that kind of visible status with whatever structure Jesus' reign is going to take. They wanted to sit in seats of power and honor, not above Jesus, not on equal par with Jesus, but on the next tier. Now, the text goes on to say that the other 10 disciples were not pleased with this request of the sons of Zebedee. You know, shouldn't there be 12 seats on that dais? I think it would have to be Peter who is probably the most indignant. You know, hey, how come I got left out this time? I'm part of the three. Well, I mean, if there's not going to be 12 chairs, there should be at least three, right? Now, even if Jesus had said, I'm going to have 6 chairs on each side of this imagined throne, you know that each of the disciples would probably still be jockeying for who got which of those 12 seats. I'm not even sure James and John decided who was on the left and who was on the right. Now, I'll give these two eager disciples credit for listening in a way to one of Jesus' parables. It's the parable that Jesus cautioned wedding bank attendees from racing to claim the best seats when they get into the banquet hall, just in case someone, and I think the phrase in a lot of translations, more distinguished than you, shows up, and then they would be embarrassingly ushered to a different seat, and probably by that time, maybe the worst of all the seats in the room. James and John were trying to secure their status as the most distinguished ones, kind of a proactive avoidance of that wedding bank embarrassing situation. But Jesus offered them a very different view than the one they assumed. In fact, Jesus says they are choosing a bad example to follow. It does appear that those who exercise authority in this world, yes, do make their own importance obvious to others. That is true. They stand above, they lord over others, literally. But this kind of greatness is not what we want, because it tends to be domineering and arrogant, Jesus tells them. And domination and arrogance can't be your way. It can't be like that for you. And then Jesus goes to his main point. Anyone among you who aspires to greatness must be one who can serve the rest. Whoever wants to rank first among you must do it through the service of all. It can't be like that for you. Perhaps this request for gifted greatness in chapter 10 is what inspired Jesus to work it into some of his follow-up teachings that Mark includes in chapter 12, just a little bit later. In a few weeks, we're actually going to read that fuller passage, and it's a cautionary teaching of Jesus, where he says, beware of those who walk around in long robes, to be greeted with respect in the marketplaces, and to have the best seats in the synagogues and places of honor at banquets. They devour widows' houses for their own sake, the sake of their appearance, saying long prayers. It can't be like that with you. Along Jesus' way, greatness has to be defined by service and community. And Jesus knew, and Jesus imagined his deepest hopes that his followers would embrace that notion, that community is built on generous and willing service, not any claimed or ascribed authority. The greatness ahead of us is defined by the great generosity we have shared on the roads behind us. As you can read in that letter that was handed out to you today, or that you might pick up on your way out, or you'll receive in the mail this week, over the weeks leading up to this year's season of Advent in December, all of us are going to be invited to reflect and to talk about how the generosity we give and receive shapes our lives, and how it deepens our connections to one another. And I would add that this must be the way with us, that generosity needs to be founded in our understanding of Jesus' calls to embrace true community-based greatness. Greatness and generosity set the tone for what can happen next. Grateful for the wonder and the mystery of God's creation, generous with the gifts of treasure and talent and time that serve a common good, where one's relative status, as defined by certain worldviews, are not a factor. It must not be that way for us. We call ourselves a community of faith, a church, and we hope to enrich and evolve our faith, but we choose to do that within community, which means that the impact of our shared faith experiences will not only has the potential to affect us as individuals, but also each other as strangers and as friends beyond this wall. Over and over again, Jesus and other biblical prophets and teachers preached against selfishness and how it leaves significant parts of our community outside the graces of some. So today, in response to what we might call a selfish request, Jesus makes it clear that our purpose is to serve more than ourselves. Generosity is the vehicle that makes service possible. And over the next 5 weeks, we will be celebrating how we have been generous, how we are being generous, and how we might be challenged to be generous as we move from full moon to full moon. Let's pray. We are grateful, gracious God, that generosity is not measured by what we give, but by the manner in which we give it. Amen. Let's pray. Wonderful God, we seek to offer prayers not only for ourselves and for our own life and in celebration and concern, but we hold each other in our prayer because we know that the well-being of the community supports the well-being of all of us who are part. We pray, God, in support and in grief of Catherine Perry and her family as they mourn the sudden death of her brother. We pray, God, for those who are dealing with health issues, for their concern about where their next path in life might take them, what changes might be before them. We pray, God, for those who are uncertain about tomorrow, uncertain because of finances or health or circumstances beyond their control. We pray, God, for everyone who is living in the difficult times of addiction. We pray, God, that we can find ways to move into ways that honor the vessels of creation that we are. We pray, God, for our community. We think especially those who will find the coming cold weather of winter a deeper hardship than for most. We pray, God, for our siblings around this world, areas of war. We think of the people of Lebanon and Israel and Gaza. We think of those who are in conflict places all around this world. So much is founded on the selfishness of a few. Hear all of these prayers, and those that are known to you, God, in the silence of our hearts, thoughts of our minds, and the depths of our soul. God, we join our voices in song as we pray Jesus' family prayer. As we take time to honor our gifts this afternoon, we're going to hear some of the impact of the story of our giving.
This is a very short excerpt from one of the publications in the on the United Church website. Stewardship is about celebrating the idea that, because this place exists, lives are changed and hope is given. Because of you, your spirituality, and your generosity, someone found something they needed to make their lives better. This is the message that the Reverend Dr. Rob Apgar Taylor shares with his congregation, Wesley Knox United in London, Ontario. As part of his leadership in stewardship, he sees his role as crafting a product or vision worth contributing to. Getting people to see what is being offered at Wesley Knox matters because what they're offering is the presence of a living God. And just a couple of short prayers. Lord, we present these gifts not as a tax write-off, but out of love. We do care about this church, and we do want to energize your will in our community and in our world. Thank you, Lord, for this beautiful place of peace where truth is alive and well, and where your people find strength in each other and in you. Bless every act of worship, but especially bless these offerings as they express our deep gratitude for life and love and hope. Amen.
Each other in our hands to journey this marvelous and wonderful
wonder-filled and mysterious world together. Let us go in peace to love and serve our God.